Colleagues and friends, good evening. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you to this event, the inaugural address of Professor Patricia Forbes from the Department of Chemistry at the University of Pretoria. I'll now hand over to our Deputy Vice-Chancellor for Academic Affairs, Professor Norman Duncan, to give a brief background and biography of the inaugurating professor. Professor Duncan.
Members of the University of Pretoria's Council and Senate, Professor Barent Erasmus, Dean of the Faculty of Natural and Agricultural Sciences, Deputy Deans Professor Vinesh Maharaj and Professor Paulette Bloemer, Professor Marilee Lantman, Acting Head of the Department of Chemistry, other academics from the University of Pretoria, as well as colleagues from other institutions, and of course Professor Patricia Forbes, Professor Forbes's family and friends, online audience, honored guests. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, it is my signal pleasure to welcome you to the inaugural lecture of Professor Forbes. Colleagues, I remind you that an inaugural lecture represents one of the most important milestones in the careers of academics, as it provides them with the opportunity to inform the university community and academia more broadly about their academic journeys. More specifically, it provides an opportunity for the newly appointed or promoted professors to share with us their research to date, as well as the direction in which they hope to steer their research in future. Above all, for us at the University of Pretoria, an inaugural lecture provides the university with an opportunity to showcase and celebrate the academic achievements of the professor presenting the inaugural lecture. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, allow me now to introduce Professor Forbes to you. Patricia Forbes joined the University of Pretoria in 2009 and is currently the holder of the Rand Water Chair in the Department of Chemistry at the University of Pretoria. In 2021, she was promoted to the level of full professor. Professor Forbes was previously employed as the environmental manager at Impala Platinum Refineries and as a senior researcher and the head of the Air Quality Research Laboratory at the CSIR. In 1993, she obtained a BSc in Chemistry and Applied Chemistry, summa cum laude, from the former University of Natal, that is, the current University of KwaZulu-Natal. In 1994, she obtained a BSc honors cum laude in chemistry from the same university. Subsequently, in 1999, Professor Forbes obtained an MSc in applied science from the University of Cape Town, and in 2010, she obtained a PhD in chemistry from the University of Pretoria. Professor Forbes' research focuses on the development of novel sampling and analytical methods for environmental pollutants, including denuder sampling techniques, biomonitors, and quantum dot-based fluorescence sensors. In 2019, Professor Forbes was awarded the prestigious ChromSA Chromatographer of the Year Award in recognition of her research achievements. She was also the recipient of the Chemical Education Award of the South African Chemical Institute in 2014. She also was awarded the International Wharton QS Reimagine Education Award for Presence Learning in 2015 and the University of Pretoria's Teaching Excellence and Innovation Laureate Award in 2016. Furthermore, Professor Forbes currently serves as the Editor-in-Chief of the South African Journal of Chemistry and as a member of the editorial boards of the journals Applied Science and Environmental Toxicology and Chemistry. She's also the managing guest editor of Method X, a journal published by Elsevier. To date, Professor Forbes has graduated 6 PhD and 14 master's students. She has published more than 80 journal papers and 12 book chapters, and over the years has raised substantial research funding through her local and international collaborations. Professor Forbes is a fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry and is an elected member of the Society's Professional Standards Board. She is a fellow of the South African Chemical Institute, and between 2011 and 2015, she served on the executive of the Institute. Professor Forbes has served as council member and chairperson of the Professional Advisory Committee for Environmental Science of the South African Council for Natural Scientific Professions. She also serves as an air pollution monitoring expert for the South African Bureau of Standards and the International Organization for Standardization. Clearly, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, Professor Forbes has had an illustrious academic career trajectory thus far. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I now invite Professor Forbes to present her inaugural lecture titled Understanding Our Environment, One Molecule at a Time.
Good evening, Professors Duncan, Erasmus, Maharaj, colleagues, collaborators, students, family, and friends. This evening, I have the pleasure and honor of sharing some of the research in environmental analytical chemistry I have conducted with my postgraduate students and collaborators, with the aim of better understanding our environment, one molecule at a time. I will start by explaining how I landed up working in this field. A decade before I was born, the iconic environmental book, Silent Spring, was published, which led to a global awakening in environmental consciousness. The environmental legislation in South Africa subsequently underwent reform, with the Environment Conservation Act being promulgated in 1989. During my chemistry undergraduate degree, I was amongst the first cohort of students to complete an environmental chemistry module, which I thoroughly enjoyed. Soon after I began working in industry, the Environmental Impact Assessment Regulations were promulgated in 1997. Followed by the National Environmental Act in 1998. These new laws required industry to conduct significantly more environmental monitoring than what had been done previously, and it soon became clear to me that this presented a challenge to local industry. Specifically, there was very limited local expertise in the monitoring of pollutants, and much of the analytical equipment required for this monitoring was not readily available in the country at the time. This led to extremely high costs of environmental monitoring, as many samples, particularly those requiring analysis of organic pollutants, had to be sent overseas for analysis. I thus decided that I wanted to use my chemistry knowledge and my passion for environmental science to assist in addressing these challenges. I furthered my qualifications in this field and then began a research career at a science council and then in academia. Environmental monitoring is required not only due to legislation in this regard, but also as South Africa is a signatory to a number of international environmental conventions which require it. Moreover, monitoring is important as there are numerous potential sources of environmental pollution, and monitoring of the pollutants present in our environment and their concentrations enables us to better understand the complex chemistry thereof. Monitoring facilitates protection of the environment and human health via evidence-based environmental management practices. The question then is, which pollutants should be monitored? Obviously, those that are legislated require monitoring, such as the criteria ambient air pollutants, or those chemicals listed in the drinking water standard, as well as additional pollutants, which may be stipulated in industrial emission or water use licenses. However, it is also important to monitor non-legislated pollutants. An example is the emerging chemical pollutants that are compounds that are not yet regulated, but which may have a negative impact on human health and the environment. Examples include pharmaceuticals and personal care products, including various constituents of the shower gels and body lotions we use on a daily basis, and indeed also those of the hand sanitizers we are now using very regularly. Environmental monitoring is a challenging field, as they are not standard or established methods for every environmental pollutant, and in some cases, the methods which do exist require extensive resources. Another challenge is that pollutants may exert their impacts at very low levels, thus requiring detection at trace levels such as parts per billion or parts per trillion quantities, which is not a trivial task. Fortunately, with ongoing developments in analytical technologies, the limits of detection are decreasing as methods become more sensitive. Sorry. The flip side to this is that the number of compounds which can be detected during an analysis concomitantly increases. Thus, it can be difficult to ascertain the pollutants of most importance in a sample in which over 1,000 compounds are identified. In my research, we seek to address the challenges of environmental monitoring by developing novel methods which are fit for purpose. It may be required that the method is simple so that it is accessible to many, or that it is fast and cost-effective to increase the number of samples which can then be analyzed, and thereby to increase the extent of environmental monitoring. Portable methods are useful as they facilitate monitoring in remote areas, and sensitive methods allow for the detection of pollutants at low levels in the environment. Selectivity is important in ensuring that the analyte of interest is detected in a mixture of numerous other compounds. The majority of my research has focused on the development of methods for monitoring organic pollutants, as these are not extensively regulated and thus are infrequently monitored in South Africa. Benzene is the only organic pollutant for which there is a national ambient air quality limit, whilst the drinking water standard provides limits for trihalomethanes, which are disinfection byproducts, phenols, and total organic carbon. Some analyses provide summative concentrations of the organic compounds present in a sample, for example, the total organic carbon content, without providing information about the specific molecules which are present. This limits our understanding of the environmental chemistry at play and makes the elucidation of potential human and environmental health impacts difficult. One class of organic compounds which we have studied extensively are the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, as they are toxic and are potential human carcinogens. PAHs consist of fused benzene rings in a planar structure. The smallest PAH being naphthalene, which is found in mothballs, which contains two benzene rings and extending up to 5 and 6 membered ring structures. The higher the number of rings, the less volatile the PAH. PAHs are produced from the incomplete combustion of organic material. Thus, they are ubiquitous in the environment, and there are many local sources thereof. Examples include the brining of meat, the burning of wood for space heating, vehicular emissions, and the burning of biomass during felt fires. When PAHs, which are semi-volatile organic compounds, enter the air, they can be in the gas phase as free molecules, or they can adsorb onto the surface of particles, such as the soot, also generated by combustion. The larger the PAH, that is, the more benzene rings it contains, the more likely it will be associated with the particle phase. Determining this partitioning between the gas and particle phase in an air sample is critical, as the penetration of each phase into the respiratory system differs when we breathe the air in, and thus the potential human health effects vary. The gas phase analyte, being smaller in size, can penetrate more deeply into the alveoli of the lungs and may enter the bloodstream, whilst larger particles may only penetrate into the nasal passages. In order to sample both gas and particle phase analytes simultaneously, we can employ the principle of denudation. Here we have a cylindrical denuder, the interior walls of which have been coated with a sorbent material. If an air sample containing both gas and particle phases is drawn through the denuder, the gas phase analyte will move to the walls of the denuder, where they will be trapped by the sorbent. Due to their lower diffusion rates, the particle phase analytes, on the other hand, will move through the denuder with the airflow and can be collected on a downstream filter. At the University of Pretoria, we developed a novel denuder consisting of 22 parallel silicone tubes housed in a glass tube about the size of a pencil. Each individual PDMS or silicone tube serves as a denuder, allowing for the collection of semi-volatile organic compounds in the gas phase. Downstream of this is a quartz fiber filter for particle phase collection, followed by a second denuder to trap any unretained analytes. Due to its open tubular design, a small battery-operated pump can be used for sampling, which provides a highly portable sampling system in contrast to most other denuder systems. After sampling, the denuder is disassembled and each individual component is analyzed using thermal desorption, that is, by heating the component again to release the analytes for analysis by gas chromatography with mass spectrometric detection. In this way, we can determine the molecular composition of the gas and particle phases in the air that was sampled. We initially tested this denuda at a sugarcane burn, as sugarcane is routinely burnt prior to harvest, which generates a significant amount of soot, as can be seen in the photograph. This experiment thus pushed the limits in terms of the requirement of our device to allow for efficient particle transmission through the PDMS denuda. It was visually evident that the denuda performed very well, in that after sampling, the denuda did not contain particles, and they had rather been collected on the filter, which was black from the soot particles. The efficiency of the denuda was subsequently validated using aerosols generated in a laboratory in collaboration with the Helmholtz Zentrum in Munich. Transmission of particles through the denuda was compared to that through an open tube or bypass line. This proved high particle transmission efficiency through the denuda and high particle collection efficiency on the filters for a range of different particle sizes and types, including ambient particles. In 2012, the World Health Organization declared that diesel engine exhaust was carcinogenic, which spurred my interest in this research area, as our denudas are well suited to the sampling of these emissions, which include the potentially carcinogenic PAHs. The first study took place in the Dustport Tunnel in Pretoria North, in collaboration with the CSIR and involving some local schoolgirls. This site was of interest due to the high traffic densities in the tunnel, combined with the daily use of the tunnel by many pedestrians, including school children, as seen in this photograph. Our study generated media interest, which resulted in some improvements being made to the infrastructure of the tunnel. Following from this, we partnered with the mining industry, which sought to develop methods for the monitoring of diesel emissions due to the use of diesel engines in the underground confined environments. This project was in collaboration with the CSIR and the Mine Health and Safety Council. The standard method, typically used for sampling diesel emissions, involves the collection of diesel particulate matter on filters, as shown in these scanning electron micrographs. The elemental carbon and organic carbon content of the particulate matter is then determined without elucidation of the specific organic compounds present. We thus employed our portable denudas in the mining environment to determine which PAH molecules were present in the gas phase and particle phase simultaneously. We sampled in a range of different underground environments at three mines, which included sampling near the exhaust of diesel vehicles, specifically the load haul dump vehicles, or LHDs. These transport mined ore from the stopes to the conveyor belts for transport to the surface. Sampling was also conducted in the underground workshops where these vehicles are serviced. Ambient air was sampled in shafts which use diesel and in shafts which do not use diesel for comparison purposes. The air in non-diesel shafts contained very few PAHs, and the naphthalene that was present most likely arose from pre-treatment of the wooden roof support beams. Whilst the range of PAHs which were detected in shafts where diesel engines are employed were much greater. These PAHs were present in both the particle phase, that is on the filter in the bottom graph, and in the gas phase, which is not usually sampled. It should be noted that the y-axis scale unit in these graphs is 1,000 times larger for the gas phase graph. Thus, the gas phase PAH concentrations were approximately 40 times higher than the particle phase. Although the heavier PAHs, which are typically associated with the particle phase, are more toxic than the lighter PAHs, it must be noted that exposure risk is a combination of toxicity and concentration. Thus, PAHs of low toxicity, but which are present at high concentrations, will also contribute to the overall health risk. This study showed the importance of including monitoring of gas phase PAH concentrations in evaluating human exposure to underground diesel emissions, which are overlooked with standard particle-based monitoring methods. In collaboration with the University of Rostock and the Helmholtz Zentrum, the PDMS denuda has thus been incorporated into a new occupational exposure sampler, the DGPS. This sampler allows for the sampling of gas and particle phase semi-volatile organic compounds, which workers may be exposed to, and we have tested it in the mining environment, as seen in the photograph. Another application where we have utilized denudas to better assess human health risks associated with PAH emissions is in households where fuel is burnt for cooking purposes. After conducting some initial studies in this regard in South Africa, we have more recently conducted research in households in Kenya with our collaborators from the Masai Mara University. The aim of our research is to better understand the impacts of various combustion parameters on the gas phase PAH concentrations in indoor air due to domestic combustion. We sampled in both urban and rural kitchens, which was possible due to the portability of the samplers. We found that the individual PAH concentrations were mostly higher overall in rural kitchens due to the fuel type used, the type of combustion device employed, as well as due to the differences in the construction of the homes. Interestingly, although the PAH concentrations were higher in the indoor air in rural areas, their concentrations in the ambient outdoor air was lower than that in urban areas, likely due to the contributions of vehicular emissions to the latter. Because we had determined the concentration of individual gas phase PAH molecules present in the indoor air, we could use this information in combination with toxicity of each PAH to determine a toxicity equivalent value for each household. Here we saw a large range in the toxicity scores, with two rural kitchens having very high values. This was due to poor combustion conditions in conjunction with poor ventilation in these homes, as can be seen in the photograph. These results clearly brought to light the importance of community engagement to promote clean combustion alternatives, as well as to highlight the importance of good ventilation in kitchens. However, it is important that these engagements are done in a manner that is sensitive to local culture and traditions. The mine and household monitoring studies I have discussed so far have focused on monitoring to inform the potential human health impacts of pollutants. I will now discuss a study which dealt with the monitoring of semi-volatile hydrocarbon emissions from diesel vehicle engines, and here we were aiming to better understand atmospheric chemistry. Combustion of fuel by vehicles leads to the emission of hydrocarbons, which may photochemically react in the atmosphere in the presence of nitrous oxides to form photochemical ozone, which is harmful to both plants and humans. Ozone is a criteria pollutant which is continuously monitored at a number of ambient air monitoring sites in South Africa. This graph shows the ozone results from monitoring stations which are located in the Highveld region from the start of this year until the end of May. The horizontal red line indicates the national ambient air quality limit value for ozone, which is 61 parts per million, and it is clear that this is exceeded on a number of occasions. It was previously thought that the hydrocarbon emissions from diesel vehicles were not volatile enough to persist in the atmosphere and to contribute to ozone formation. The lighter hydrocarbons emitted from petrol vehicles were thought to be more important in this regard. However, more recently, there have been concerns that the contribution by diesel engines may in fact be significant and may assist in explaining some of the high ozone levels we find in hydrographic areas. We therefore sought to determine the levels of N-alkanes and alkyl benzenes emitted by diesel engines, as these hydrocarbons are known to react readily to form ozone. These emissions had not been fully characterized previously due to challenges in sampling and analyzing these complex mixtures. We addressed this knowledge gap with collaborators at the Sasol Fuels Application Center, where we sampled gas phase emissions from a light vehicle diesel engine in a controlled test cell facility using our denuders. The World Harmonized Light Vehicle Test Cycle was employed, which consists of different driving phases to simulate real-world driving conditions. The test cell engine emissions are regularly analyzed for total hydrocarbon content using a flame ionization detector, but this does not provide the concentrations of individual compounds present. Analysis of diesel vehicle emission samples by gas chromatography with mass spectrometric detection is also difficult, thus leading to the reporting of the total concentration of an unresolved complex mixture, or UCM, of a range of hydrocarbons. Again, this does not provide individual molecular information, making it impossible to determine emission factors for each hydrocarbon and also making an estimation of ozone formation potential of the emissions highly tenuous. We thus employed two-dimensional gas chromatography with mass spectrometric detection, which separates the sample mixture based on two properties of the compounds, specifically their volatility and polarity. In this way, we can separate the mixture and allow for resolution thereof down to the individual molecules which are present. We could thus quantify each enalkane in the emission samples from octane to icosane, which is a chain of 20 carbon atoms, as shown in the insert. Emission factors for each compound in milligrams emitted per kilometer driven could thus be calculated for the different different diesel fuels which we tested, shown here for the medium phase of the test cycle as an example. The impact of after-treatment systems, such as a diesel oxidation catalyst or a diesel particle filter, on these emission factors could also be determined. Using the individual enalkane concentrations and the reactivity thereof to form ozone, we could determine the overall ozone formation potential of the emissions from the diesel engine for different fuels and under different driving conditions, such as during the low and medium phases of the test cycle, as shown in the bottom right graph. This allows us to better understand the tropospheric ozone levels observed in high traffic areas and can in turn inform air quality management practices. The PDMS samplers we used in the Dunedas are suitable for semi-volatile organic compounds. Thus, we set out to broaden the range of organic analytes we can sample to include more volatile analytes as well. We synthesized a novel graphene wool adsorbent using chemical vapor deposition to coat graphene layers onto quartz wool as a substrate. This provides a porous material suitable for packing into glass tubes for air pollutant sampling. We optimized the packing density of the new samplers in collaboration with the Helmholtz-Zentrum, and we measured gas collection efficiencies of octane of over 90%. We thus proceeded to compare the performance of the graphene wool traps to both the commercial absorbents and PDMS traps. We achieved this by sampling volatile emissions generated by a combustion aerosol sanded system. Upon sampling emissions produced from combustion of a range of fuels, including biodiesel, we found that the graphene wool traps performed well. When we attempted to thermally desorb the analytes from the graphene wool samplers, we found that the graphene wool adsorbs semi-volatile organic compounds very strongly, thus prompting the idea to use this material as an adsorbent for water treatment applications, that is, to remove organic contaminants from water. We have subsequently shown very good removal efficiencies of graphene wool for both PAHs and antiretroviral drugs from water. Due to the high usage of ARVDs in South Africa by over 5 million people, these pharmaceuticals have been found in our surface waters and are thus considered a class of emerging chemical pollutants. Removal of ARVDs by conventional wastewater treatment processes varies for different compounds, but less than 60% removal efficiency has been reported for the two compounds we studied. Graphene wool, on the other hand, was found to remove over 80% of these compounds, which is very encouraging. In order to be able to screen water samples for the presence of emerging chemical pollutants, we have also developed novel fluorescent sensors based on quantum dots. Quantum dots are highly fluorescent nanocrystals that are between 2 and 10 nanometers in diameter. This means that a line of 2 million 10 nanometer diameter quantum dots would be as wide as your thumb. In synthesizing the quantum dots, we typically prepare core quantum dots, which we then coat with a shell layer to improve the fluorescence properties of the quantum dots, and also to prevent leakage of toxic cadmium from the core during use. We then attach ligands, such as L-cysteine, to the surface of the core shell quantum dots to make them soluble in water. Quantum dots have many interesting properties due to their very small size. One of these is that their fluorescence is tunable, and that, as the quantum dots grow in size during synthesis, their fluorescence emission shifts to longer wavelengths. As can be seen in the photograph, the fluorescence changed from green to orange as the size of the quantum dots increased from left to right. We can thus synthesize quantum dots with specific fluorescence properties as required for the particular sensing application at hand. We can use the quantum dots directly, but we have also synthesized quantum dot nanocomposites to enhance the interaction thereof with our target pollutants. Here we see the incorporation of the quantum dots into graphene oxide nanosheets by means of these transmission electron microscopy images. We would represent the synthesis chemically as follows. And when we then interact the quantum dot nanocomposite with the water pollutant, which in this case was phenanthrene, a commonly found three-ring pH, we can detect an enhancement in the fluorescent signal from the quantum dots, which is proportional to the magnitude of the concentration of the phenanthrene that is present in the water sample. Alternatively, in order to improve the selectivity of the quantum dot sensor, we can coat the quantum dots with molecularly imprinted polymers. These polymers are synthesized in the presence of the target water pollutant, which is later removed from the polymer by washing, leaving behind cavities that are complementary in size and shape to that of the target pollutant. Thus, when the material subsequently comes into contact with that pollutant again in a water sample, it binds selectively to the molecularly imprinted polymer and yields a fluorescence response. Here we used this approach to detect acetaminophen, also called paracetamol, as this commonly used pain relief medication is an emerging chemical pollutant in surface water. Due to the selective binding of acetaminophen with the molecularly imprinted polymer, we see a far greater fluorescence response of the sensor than when no imprinting is employed. That is, in the case of a non-imprinted polymer, or NIP. Other pharmaceuticals of similar chemical structure do not fit the cavities as well, and thus do not generate this marked fluorescence response, which in this case was fluorescence quenching. This demonstrates the selectivity of the sensor and allows us to detect a specific molecule in the presence of others. In looking forward, standard methods for monitoring environmental pollutants are under regular review to keep up with the developments in the analytical chemistry field. These include the standards of ISO, the International Organization for Standardization, as well as those of our local South African Bureau of Standards, which are often based on the international standards. The scope in terms of which pollutants are covered by legislation and their associated limit values is also evolving. As our usage of chemicals changes with time, and as our knowledge about the effects of these chemicals, which land up in an environment, expands, ever more environmental pollutants need to be monitored. Ongoing novel exploratory research in the field of environmental monitoring is therefore required, as monitoring is vital to better understand sources and concentrations of pollutants of both current and emerging concern. We can thereby better assess the potential impacts to human health and the environment. Our research will continue to push the boundaries in terms of developing methods which can do this. That is, to better understand our environment, one molecule at a time. I would like to acknowledge the funders of my research over the years, without which it would not have been possible. I would like to particularly thank the University of Pretoria and my colleagues in the Department of Chemistry for creating a conducive and enabling environment for academic research. In particular, I would like to thank Professor Egmond Rover for his guidance and encouragement throughout my academic career. Special thanks to my husband Andrew and my daughter Juliet for their support and love, as well as that of my extended family and friends. I'm very fortunate to have Andrew, who is a distinguished academic, and Juliet, who is wise beyond her years, to provide me with a valuable sounding board and give me the confidence to aim high. I sincerely acknowledge my talented postgraduate students, both past and present. It is a privilege to mentor you, and I'm very proud of your excellent achievements, some of which I have discussed in this presentation. I thank and acknowledge the substantive contributions of my local and international collaborators. It is both inspiring and a pleasure to work with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Forbes. As an environmental scientist myself, I now have a very, very revised appreciation of the importance of deep chemistry and chemical scholarship to understand the changes in the environment around us so much better. I think there's few better examples of the interaction of basic disciplines such as chemistry with the cross-disciplinary and interdisciplinary challenges of environmental change and sustainability around us. Thank you very much for that insight. I'd also like to recognize that Professor Patricia Forbes not only makes this contribution in her own field of study, but also I'd like to have a particular word of thanks to her leadership role in the Department of Chemistry and the role that she's played so far and continues to play in making sure that this is one of the eminent departments in the country and definitely on an upward trajectory. Thank you very much for that. Thank you to Professor Norman Duncan for the introduction and giving us the full background of Professor Patricia Forbes' journey until where we are now. I'd be remiss not to recognize the importance of family here. A particular word of thanks to Juliet and Andrew for the role that you play in enabling Professor Forbes to reach the heights and the impact that she has. As an academic myself, I've got no hesitation, and I'm deeply familiar with the sacrifices that sometimes goes hand in hand with the support. Thank you very much. Lastly, thank you to Spatial Studios for the professional studio as usual, and also thank you to Ms. Marie Venter and the communications and marketing team from the Faculty of Natural and Agricultural Sciences. Colleagues and friends, thank you very much for joining us this evening, and I wish you a safe journey. Stay safe and vaccinate. Good evening.